Good morning, everyone. How are y'all doing this morning? Y'all ready to worship today?
Yeah.
Are you ready?
Yes,
ma'am. That doesn't sound like you're ready. Are you excited to be in the house of the Lord today? Let's just prepare our hearts and our minds and everything else and get ready to worship the King of Kings today. Let's pray. God, we thank you so much for the opportunity to come here together today. God, we love you so much. We just want to honor you. We just want to pour out our praise on you this morning. God, we want to lift up our gifts to you. We want to lift up our voices to you. God, we've come here today, and I know we've all come here looking for something and just needing to hear from you, needing to be close to you, needing to be close to fellow believers today. God, we thank you for this institution that we call church, where we can just be a body of believers together with one purpose of worshiping you. God, we thank you for all the other churches in our community and in the area that are coming together this morning to worship you too, Lord, because we are all one family. Lord, I thank you that the church is going to rise up in these days, Lord, and just show the world what you're all about. God, I pray that you would just be with us here today as we make you the honored guest, as we put you on the throne, as we worship you and we honor you, and that we would just have our hearts right with you, and we would just put away everything else that we've got going on, Lord, because you know we're so busy. Just forget about those things just for this moment right now and just focus on you. God, help us to make you the sole object of our affection and our desire today. Lord, we want more of you. We want to know you more. We want to be closer to you. And we just want to honor you and glorify you today. And everybody said, amen. Amen. If you would, let's stand as we worship him. This song that says, there is joy in the house of the Lord today. How many of you feel joy?
We worship the God who is, we worship the God who lives and moves.
got to close your eyes and do it, block out all the stuff, and just say the one thing that you're so thankful to God for today. Just say it to Him. I am so thankful for His patience with me. Whew. Man, He should have gave up on me a long time ago. He's still patient with me. Let's just make sure we get our focus. We got an awesome God we serve. We worship Him, and I know we all got stuff. He just kind of brought it all in with us, and we'll carry it out with us, and we'll get more stuff before today's over. But let's just stop and praise the Lord and focus on Him and worship Him. It's so good to see you. Welcome to a cool, comfortable place that we call Open Arms Fellowship. It's not sticky, humid, and ain't too many gnats in here yet. And so this is good to see you. If this is your first trip to Open Arms, or if you're one of us online for the first time, we'd love to hear you, because you can find us online and send us a card there. But if you're here, we would love for you to grab one of these before you go out the door and learn more about us so that we can learn more about you. Or if you got a prayer need, you got a prayer request, there's a card under a chair or somewhere around you. Get one of these, fill it out, put it in our offering box, because you know what? I know there's a bunch of cool people in this room. And some of you, I don't know. I'd love to get a card that tells me more about you so I can get to know you a little bit more. And you know what? I bet all of us got a prayer need. It's like, man, preacher, pray for me, but if you just tell me, I'll probably forget. Put it on the card. Put it in the box. I'd love to pray for you. And we have a prayer time together. And everybody's invited, if you would like to join us right here. There's a cross over there. There's a cross in the back. You said, man, I just really feel like I want to pray at the foot of a cross today. You're invited to do that. Or right there where you are, as we go to the Lord in prayer this morning. Father, I thank you so much for the gift of worship. Yeah, I got stuff too, and just to be able to focus and singing that song, and it just puts all the stuff away. And Lord, I just had to think about, what is it right now I'm so thankful for you about? And the list can go on and on, but you are such a patient God. Wow. A loving God. Forgiving. Grace, mercy, correction, judgment, and I need all those things and many more. Thank you for being holy. I know that's not a word we use a lot, but you are holy, holy, holy. Absolute, perfect in every way, in everything you do, every word you say. Thank you. I need that. We need that. Thank you, Lord, for creating this family called church. And thank you for the freedom we have to worship. Thank you for men and women in this room and others who have given their lives so that we can enjoy doing what we're doing. Let us never take it for granted. Let us never think it's just another Sunday. Oh, this is a great opportunity. An opportunity that many believers around the world can't do. We're blessed to do it in a comfortable, air-conditioned place, and just a wonderful time of worship. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for your word. We're going to dive into it a little bit, and we need your word to guide us and direct us. Thank you, Lord, for prayer and answered prayers. And Lord, I just enjoyed yesterday unloading a truck, and Mr. Ray was out there with us, and he's had so many health problems, and yet, Lord, you brought him through it. Lord, you brought so many people through so many things, and yet we all got more prayer needs. Thank you, Lord, that you still do miracles. Lord, for that those names on our list that we get when we come in the door, just lift those people up. Just pray for those people and watch you do stuff. Thank you. Lord, let us keep pushing that stuff aside, the distractions of life.
worship you. Really. Let me look to you face to face. Just if we have to dream about being in the throne room of God, and you're in heaven, praising and singing, looking at Jesus at the right hand of the Father. Just get wrapped up in you, Lord. Thank you.
What I was really looking for was that void to fill. that Jesus has told in my heart. Looking for romance or turning to alcohol and drugs or whatever it may be. So many times we look to the world to fill that need inside of us when really we're just looking for Him. Really all we need is to just give it up, surrender to Him, and we can finally see that it's Jesus. Jesus who we've been looking for. Because He's got all that we need. All that we could ever want and need, more than we could ever want and need. And He can do more than we can even ask or imagine. So if you feel like that's you today and you're just looking for something, and every time you think you know, if I just get this thing, then I can be successful, or I'll be happy. And you get it and you find that wasn't it. If you feel like that's you today, I encourage you to turn to Jesus, to accept Him, to just let your guard down and let all that other stuff go, because He is what you're looking for. This next song is called Honey in the Rock, and that's what it's about. It's just that He supplies all of our needs. He is what we need for every situation, for everything, things we don't even know we need yet. He is all that we need. He supplies all that we need. And sometimes it may come from unexpected things or places or people, but He has all that we need. So if you would, let's stand this morning as we worship Him, as we sing this song. If you listen to Christian radio, I know you've heard it before. Honey in the Rock. There's honey in the rock, water in the stone, manna on the ground, no matter where I go. I don't need to worry now that I know. Everything I need, you've got. There's honey in the rock. Living well. Amen.
Working on.
But we know who brings the day.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Oh, I may not know what a day may bring, but I know who brings the day. On the darkest night when I cannot see, oh, still my soul will say, oh, I may not know what the day may bring, but I know who brings the day. On the darkest night when I cannot see, oh, still my soul will say.
Thank you.
What if we could love the way Jesus did? Passionately, faithfully, powerfully. What if the way we love could make a difference in the world around us? What if that love looked at everyone the way God does? A love which doesn't see the past, but is consumed by a desire to see people come to know Jesus. A love which is patient and kind, not envious or prideful. A love which puts others before ourselves, chooses peace over anger. A love which protects, trusts, hopes, perseveres. Do we love like this? Do we love like Jesus? Maybe it's time to ask a simple question. How can we love better?
Next week is a special day because we're going to celebrate and honor our fathers, but it's also a special day because we're going to have a baptism service. So, if you have been praying and the Lord has been putting on your heart to be baptized, please see me or one of our leaders today. Let us talk to you about that and get ready to celebrate baptism and Father's Day next Sunday. I know growing up, we lived on a hill. Everything's on a hill in the upstate. But we lived on a big hill, had very little grass, and probably why I hate grass and cutting grass, but we had lots of rocks. And I don't know if you've noticed this, but it's something about kids, and especially little boys, we just like to throw rocks. Just get a kid near some water, and what they're looking for, rock, I want to throw a rock. And so growing up, we had lots of rocks. And because we lived on a hill, there's a little road down below our house and a pasture, and oftentimes we would just have a rock throwing contest. Who could throw the rock the furthest? Just, you know, of course, you know, you always argued over who won because it bounced and all that. Sometimes we'd set up some cans or some bottles, throw rocks, see if we could bust them. The one thing we liked doing, and maybe it's because we knew we weren't supposed to do it, but it was just something so cool about hitting a road sign with a rock. Bang! Don't do that! We just love throwing rocks. I don't know what it is about kids and throwing rocks, but you know what I've learned as I've grown up? I still bring that desire with me to throw rocks. The only thing is I've turned it into words. Instead of actually throwing real rocks, I don't know when the last time I picked up a real rock and just threw it, but turn my rocks into words. Often throw those out, creating some damage. And I don't want to do that. There's things going on in my world. There's things going on in our world that I don't like. Things that I see on the news that bothers me. Things that are going on in our culture that bothers me. And I find myself wanting to throw a rock. I don't want to throw a rock. I want to have the right response. I need to have the right response. Most all of us are watching the news, and we see things in the news, and we see things in our community, and it kind of gets our blood boiling, and we want to do something, we want to say something, and we want to have... We want to throw a rock. And if you're a Democrat, you're like, I don't understand how in the world those Republicans think that way. If you're a Republican, you're like, I don't see how in the world those Democrats can think that way. And if you're conservative, you're like, I don't see how liberals can live that way. And if you're liberal, you're like, I don't understand how those conservatives can live that way. And so we just see this division and these differing ideas, and it creates tension in our life, and we want to do something. Usually we want to throw a rock. But it's more than just differences of opinions, because they've been around forever. We're actually seeing some cultural changes in our nation that's scary. I never would have thought in my lifetime that Christianity would be labeled as a hate crime by some people or a hate group. I would have never imagined Christians getting fired from their jobs in America because they wouldn't give in to a certain point of view. And so we're seeing some fundamental changes, and we want to do something about it. So what's the right way to handle it? How do we deal with that? What's the right response? Because we often just want to do what's right in our own eyes. And you know what? That changes with every set of eyes. So we don't need to do what's right in our eyes. We need to do what's right in the Lord's eyes. Because you know what? I've figured out that it doesn't do any good for me to try to prove somebody wrong because they're trying to prove me wrong. And it doesn't do any good for me to argue with somebody because they're arguing with me that I'm wrong. I want the right response. So how do we deal with an ever-changing culture? How do we deal with liberalism and conservatism, and how do we deal with the gay movement, and how do we deal with transgender, how do we deal with abortion, how do we deal with alcoholism, drug abuse? You just keep naming them. There's plenty of things on the list. How do we deal with that? We need a right response. And you know what? God's been dealing with that since He created humanity. God's been dealing with the ills of humanity and sinfulness of humanity. You know, we don't know the timeline. We don't know how long it was from when God made Adam and Eve until they sinned. But the Bible indicates it probably wasn't a very long period of time. And God had the right response. And then when we journey through the Old Testament, we see God taking the nation of Israel and blessing them in so many ways and doing everything in the world for them, and they just keep sinning against Him and rejecting Him, and yet God always has the right response. And then God took on flesh and came to earth as Jesus, and he walked among sinful people, and he always had the right response. And He went to a cross, gave His life on that cross as a picture of the perfect response. And as I was thinking about this journey and this message, you know, since 1964, God has been dealing with this sinful guy. And He's always had the right response. So I think the best place to get the right response would be our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Let's pray as we look at a story Jesus. Father, we do see things all around us that just, it bothers us. We see our nation and things happening in our nation, it bothers us. Maybe we look in the mirror as we should sometimes and see things in our own life that bothers us. We need the right response. Not right, as I think is right, or that group thinks is right, or my friends thinks is right, or my social media posts say it's right. We need the right response from You, Lord, because all Your responses are right. So, Lord, by Your Holy Spirit and by Your Word, and by You changing our hearts and minds today, may we learn, not just learn a story, not just learn about a story, learn what You said and learn what You did. Help us to do that today. Amen. I had a mentor years ago who told me that it is so important to know what Jesus said, but it's just as important to know what Jesus did, because both of them are holy and inspired. What He did and what He said, they're both equally holy and inspired. I want to give you a background before we jump into this story today. There's a lot going on in this story. In fact, this story reminded me so much of so much things going on in our world and in our culture and on our news broadcast and maybe even our own lives, because so many of these things are going on not just in our nation, but even in our families, because we have family members of radically different viewpoints than we may have, and doing things radically different than we think they should. And so this stuff is real. We face it every day. And so what's going on in this story? The Gospel of John, is kind of an abbreviated picture of Jesus' life, because the Holy Spirit led John to focus on the sayings of Jesus and the proclamation or the claims of Jesus that he was God in the flesh. So we get an abbreviated version of Jesus' life in the book of John. Now, where we're jumping into the story is Jesus had just made the proclamation. He was in the temple courtyard. There was a huge festival going on. There's probably thousands of people gathered at the temple, and he proclaims that he's God in the flesh. And one group saying, yeah, he's the Messiah, make him king. And there's another group saying, no, he's blaspheming, let's kill him. So nothing's really changed in humanity, right? There's always two sides, and that sides are arguing for their point of view. And so that's what's going on. Yes, he's king, make him king. No, he's failed, he's lying, let's kill him. And so this is all going on. This tension's going on. This massive break out of an argument against this side and that side's going on, and this has all happened in the most public place of their time, in the temple court. Now this event has probably happened the day before the story we're about to look at. As best we can tell in history, that happened in that day, and now we catch this story, John chapter 8, verse 1. I hope you got a Bible. Did you love to read? Love to understand, and if you don't, I would love to give you one. John chapter 8, verse 1. Jesus went to the Mount of Olives. Early the next morning, he returned to the temple courtyard. All the people went to him, so he sat down and began to teach them. Really, if we jump back to chapter 7, the last verse of 7, which is verse 53, should go with this, because it says, then each of them went home. So it is very likely we had this huge confrontation in the temple courtyard in chapter 7. Evening came, they all went home. We come to chapter 8, and we see that Jesus went somewhere else. Look where it says Jesus went. He went to the Mount of Olives. Now, Jesus didn't have this really nice condo on the Mount of Olives that looked over Jerusalem that he got to hang out in. In fact, to our biblical knowledge, there was no dwelling place on the Mount of Olives. The Mount of Olives for Jesus was his getaway place, his place of prayer, his place with the Father, his place where he taught the disciples. Here is one of the most important keys and us having the right response to the things in our world and the things in our life. It's right here, guys. Don't miss it. It is a huge step. Jesus got away to be with his Father. Jesus had already been in conflict. He knew more conflict was coming. He got away to be with his Father. That's what he did on the Mount of Olives. Was his getaway place. You say, why? Wasn't Jesus God in the flesh? Yes, he was, but he was in the flesh. And he didn't want the flesh to be ruling. And Jesus says it so many times to the Gospels. He wanted to do the will of the Father. He wanted to do the will of the Father. And so he spent time with the Father. He also did it as an example for us. We need our Mount of Olives. We need it every day, because here's the truth. We don't know when confrontation is coming. We don't know when somebody's going to get in our face and somebody's going to challenge our views and our ideas or accuse us or claim this and just get our blood boiling and get us to the point of just throwing a rock. So we need our time with the Father. It is absolutely necessary. We're going to have the right response. We need it daily. We need it in his word. We need it in our prayer. We need to get away from all the stuff and just be with the Father. Because he knows what's coming. We don't.
He knows what we need to be prepared for what's coming. We don't.
And our time with the Father is one of the key elements in this to get us ready for the right response. Well, verse 2 tells us what Jesus was doing. He went back to the courtyard, and there's some people gathered around, and he's teaching them. So he's, and in their day and time, Jesus would have been sitting among the people. It wouldn't have been like a stage. This is American style. In his day, he'd have been sitting down, a group of people around him, he's teaching. Well, let's see what happens next in verses 3 to 6. The experts in Moses' teachings and the Pharisees brought a woman who had been caught committing adultery. They made her stand in front of everyone, and they asked Jesus, "Teacher, we caught this woman in the act of adultery. In his teachings, Moses ordered us to stone women like this to death. What do you say?" They asked this to test him. They wanted to find a reason to bring charges against him. There's a lot going on in the story. I want us to take it piece by piece. Notice what happens first. Look, I want you to end this story. Man, I don't know, it's been a while since I got into a story about Jesus like this one. Picture the scene. Jesus is just teaching people who wanted to come in here and teach. And he gets rudely interrupted by these experts and Pharisees. I mean, they just come busting on the scene. Bring this woman there who is probably in disarray because she doesn't want to be there. They make her stand in front of Jesus and them and all the people. They just come busting in on Jesus' scene. How do you react? How do we react when somebody come busting in on our scene? They come busting in on our conversation, busting in on our hobby, busting in on our time on television, busting in on our conference, busting in on our political views, busting in on whatever. And we're seeing it, you know, in our culture. We see it on the news. So-and-so speaking, and this group come busting in on their conversation and make a big scene. That's exactly where Jesus went. Some of you already got your blood boiling. I'm busting him, I'm bust back. You don't know why I'm right in front of you. That's what happened. Jesus just teaching. Boom! They just come in. Take control of the situation. Whew. We need a right response to that, don't we? Because it happens. It happens at work, happens in the store, happens even in our family gatherings of people who have different viewpoints than we do. They just come busting in our suit. Well, let's see what else is happening in the story. The experts and Pharisees. Now, these guys are totally opposite of the views of Jesus. Okay? These guys are part of the crowd who the day before, or likely the day before, were in the crowd saying, "Kill him! Kill him! He's wrong!" These guys are adamantly, confidently sure that they're right and Jesus is wrong. Jesus, who's always right, he knows they're wrong. Boy, doesn't this sound like a modern scene from the news last night? This group over here, we know we're right, you're wrong. This group over here, no, I know I'm right, and you're wrong. That's what we have here. These guys are convinced that Jesus is wrong, and they got to stop him. Whatever it takes. Even if they got to kill him, they got to stop him. And they have a response to Jesus, and Jesus has a response to them. They want to kill Jesus. It won't be long before Jesus actually dies for them. Whoa. I don't know about that response. This group wants to shut me up and stop me. My response is, that's all right, I'm going to die for you anyway. I'm going to give my life for you. That might change some of our responses to some of the situations we're in. The especially when we know we may be in the right. Jesus was in the right. Jesus is always right. Jesus had a right to blast him back. Jesus had a right to strike him down with lightning from heaven. No worries, I'm going to die for you in a short period of time. Don't get too riled up. You're not going to kill me, but I'm going to die for you. The right response. Well, there's more going on in the story. Look what else is going on in the story. Because right in the middle of the story, another element is thrown in. A woman, an unnamed woman, who's brought in not of her own desires, is brought into the middle of this fight that's going on. And this storm is going on. And she's made to stand there. She didn't want to be there in front of all those people. And the scriptures tell us she was caught in the act of adultery. In fact, some translations even say she was in the act of adultery. Now, in case in our culture we've forgotten what adultery is when a married person has sex with somebody outside of their spouse. We like to say it's an affair, it was a bad choice of judgment, it was a mistake. No, the Bible says it's adultery and it's a sin. And she was caught in the very act of adultery. Now think about that a minute. If you're going to catch somebody in the very act of adultery, you got to be watching somebody. You got to be knowing what somebody is doing, because she wouldn't have been making this act of adultery out in public. She would have been trying to hide her act of adultery. So we kind of begin to understand there's a setup. In fact, verse 6 tells us it's a test. They're testing Jesus. They want to get Jesus. See, they want to find something wrong with Jesus and what he says or what he does so that they can get him publicly in front of others. They want to accuse him of saying something wrong. Something wrong against Scripture or something wrong against what he's been teaching. And so they're trying to put Jesus in a pickle here. Maybe we've experienced that with those people or that family member or that organization, and they tried to get us at our words. You said that. You acted that way. Thought you was a Christian. Thought you were supposed to da-da-da. They fill in the blanks. So you're trying to get us. That's exactly what these guys are doing. This is a setup to get us. Get Jesus. Oh man, when we know somebody's trying to set us up, that's when the blood really starts to boil. We start grabbing up some big rocks. And, you ain't gonna rock and try to get me. I'm gonna get you before you get me. I bet we need a right response right there, don't we? There's more to this story. These experts were just that. They really were experts in the Old Testament and the law. I mean, these guys studied this stuff. They would put us to shame memorizing Old Testament scripture. These guys had it memorized. And they were absolutely right in what they were proclaiming, because in Deuteronomy, God said, in the book of Deuteronomy, people caught in the act of adultery, both the man and the woman, are supposed to be stoned to death. And we're like, oh, that's so harsh. But guys, God takes sin very seriously. He always has. He always will. But even in the story, we see a problem, don't we? Where'd the man? Oh, where'd the man at? But if these guys were so bent on carrying out the word of God, like God said, they would have both of them there and ready to stone both of them. See? So concerned about God's law as they are about getting Jesus. See, this confrontation, it's real. They're trying to put Jesus in a lose-lose situation. See, Jesus had been going around teaching love, grace, mercy. He had even forgiven sins. That really got right there, Bloodborne.
He'd been healing people. So they got it now.
Because see, if Jesus doesn't address this adulterous woman, he breaks the law. If he doesn't say, let's stone her, he breaks the law. Got it. Or if he says, we're going to stone her, then he ruins the character that he's been portraying for the last year or so in being gracious and loving and merciful to people and forgiving people. So they got him now. He needs a right response like we do so often when people got us. Well, let's look what Jesus did. Verse 6, the second part. Jesus bent down and used his finger to write on the ground. When they persisted in asking him questions, he straightened up and said, the person who is sinless should be the first to throw a stone at her. Then he bent down again and continued writing on the ground. One by one, beginning with the older men, the experts in Moses' teachings, and the Pharisees left. Jesus was left alone with the woman. You see Jesus' response. I love Jesus' response. It's so opposite to what we're used to in our culture. It's so opposite to what we feel like we should do. See, when somebody comes at us, we automatically think we need to come at them. And so often when somebody comes at us, we make the biggest mistake by letting them control the situation, causing our emotions to get riled up, saying things we shouldn't say, or even saying the right things but in the wrong way because we're all riled up because they got us riled up. Jesus is. We don't know what Jesus wrote. We don't know how long Jesus wrote. But we know from verse 7, he wrote in the ground long enough that it just irritated these people because they persisted. What you going to say? What you going to say? They just wouldn't leave him alone. So I don't know how long he wrote me. You see what Jesus' response really is by doing that? Jesus was in control. See, they thought they were in control. Come busting in on his scene. They're demanding an answer. Jesus says, oh yeah, watch this. You gotta give us an answer. Maybe our best response is the way to move. Jesus didn't need this time to figure out what he was going to say or what he was going to do. He already knew. Jesus did this for us. To say, slow down a minute. Take a breath. Don't let them control you. Don't let you control you. Stop a minute and let the Holy Spirit control you. You may even have the right response, but you may say it in the wrong way because you're all riled up and you want to get back in their face like they got in yours. Just chill, man. Let them know that they don't have control of the situation. Jesus got control of the situation. And Jesus needs to have control of me when I'm in that situation. So I need to just... amazing how silence would diffuse tension. My dad was an art at this. My dad never argued. Never. My mama would like to argue. She argued with us boys a lot, especially my older brother. Daddy didn't argue. Here's how Daddy responded. I've seen my mom get even more angry because Daddy didn't say that. You can't argue with somebody who don't say anything. My wife came from a little more argumentative family. And in our dating days, she wanted to get me into arguments. I learned something from my dad. I was a nut. She found out pretty quick. I can't argue with somebody who don't say anything. So why bother? It's just something about our human nature. We want to come back just like somebody comes at us. We just, our culture has taught us that the loudest voice is the one who's in control, and it's not true. And I don't know about you, but most of the things that I've said that I shouldn't have said, and the ways I've said things that I shouldn't have said them that way, was because I was reacting to someone else. And if I'd have stopped, let the Holy Spirit take control of this flesh instead of me, it might not have got as ugly as it did, and things said that hurt people and divisions created, and it just calmed down. Jesus said the right response. He was like, hey, watch this. I'm going to draw on the sand. What you going to do about that? But then when Jesus does say something, it is so huge. It's so huge for this crowd, it's so huge for you, it's so huge for me. Before we react to some other group, some other ideology, some other person coming at us, some other way of lifestyle, whatever list or name or title you want to put on it, before we do that, before we throw the stone, need to evaluate the sin in our life. We may even be in a place where Jesus was and that we are in the right. But unlike Jesus, we're not sinless. So before we think we can grab the stone and throw it, we need to do some evaluation of our own sinfulness. You know, it's amazing how we think our sin is not as bad as that person's sin. You know, that group, those people who do that, that's just such a horrible, sickening sin. And it probably is. But guess what? Mine is too. It's interesting that the scripture will tell us that from the oldest to the youngest, these experts begin to walk out. I don't know exactly why, I just speculate. Maybe the oldest recognized how many more sins were in their lives. Maybe in this time of silence, they begin to evaluate for a while. So before we grab a stone, we need to take Jesus at his word. Folks, do you realize if we would take Jesus at this one statement, how much less we would say about others and how much more we would clean up our own lives? You know the old saying is, when I point a finger at you, I'm pointing three at me. Right response. Well, what else happened in the story? Verses 10 and 11. Then Jesus straightened up and he asked her, where did they go? Has anyone condemned you? The woman answered, no one, sir. Jesus says, I don't condemn you either. Go. From now on, don't sin. Conviction from the Lord had got these experts and Pharisees out of the stone throwing business. My sin takes me out of the stone throwing business. But don't miss this story. Don't miss the end of this story, because a lot of people want to misuse this story to say, well, I can live as I want to and you can't say I'm wrong. And this story has been used for that, and that is not true. Look at the end of the story. Look at what Jesus says. He says, there's nobody condemning you. She says, no, sir, nobody's condemning. They're gone. Look what Jesus says. I don't condemn you either. Now, here's where we need to study. The word condemn here means to be damned to hell. It means a permanent punishment. My friends, none of us stand in a place of right or authority to condemn anything. Even Jesus, at this point in time in history, when he was on earth, wasn't here to condemn anyone. In fact, he was here to do just the opposite, because he's about to go to the cross and die for this woman and die for those experts and Pharisees and die for you and me, so we won't be condemned to hell. And Jesus says, I ain't condemning you either. And don't miss even to the last word. Stop sinning. See, part of the tension in our culture now is that we don't have a right response. Yes, we still need to call sin, sin. Jesus did. This woman was in sin, he said, stop sinning. But there's a right way to do that and a wrong way to do that. And so often we bring condemnation in our conversation to this person who may be in sin, and that is dividing us in ways that it's going to be very hard for us as humans to ever bridge that gap ever again, because we're condemning. And I've heard it even from church people. Condemning this group or that person or that way of life. Yes, sin is sin, and God has placed us on this earth to recognize sin, but we need to do it with the right response. Because the scriptures tell us we're all sinners. We all deserve the rocks to be thrown at us, and none of us deserve to throw the rocks. And this tension, these conflicts, they're real and they're happening in our lives and they're happening all around us, and they may even be happening to people we're close to and we love them because they're in our family. We just don't understand how they can live that way or think that way or act that way. And we need a right response. Like Jesus did. You know your right response to sin today. Know that in this story, Jesus never ignored the sin. Jesus will never ignore sin. Ever. And one day he will condemn people to hell. We do not want to face Jesus with sin in our life. So the right response to sin in our life is to come to Jesus. Call on Jesus as Lord and Savior. He still don't ignore the sin. He just takes the sin on himself. He says, yeah, I'll pay the price for you. He don't ignore it. He will never ignore sin. We're only hurting ourselves when we try to ignore it. So today, if you know something's going on in your life, you know some sin going on, don't ignore it, because God won't. Come give it to him. And take it. Christian, those people in the news, those people who are against us, those people we built a wall between, even family members, what's the right response? What do you need to do today, Christian, so that you would have the right response? Would you stand with me as I pray? Holy Spirit, you're speaking to us today. We have a choice of a right response to you. that response is to come to an altar and pray, or to go to the cross and pray, or maybe it's to come and talk to one of us, pray with someone. Lord, we need a right response to you first and foremost. And we need a right response as we deal with an ever-changing culture. So Lord, let it begin as we make a right response.